I begin with the second sutra of Atisha. These are the sutras of mind training. The second sutra is see positive in the negative. Every moment negative trend tends to breed in our mind. Naturally, mind is negatively oriented. In everything it looks negatively because this is how we are conditioned. When a woman gets pregnant for the first time, she is not expecting. All of a sudden she comes to know that I am pregnant, and her first response to that is oh, oh, and this sinks deep into our psychology. Anytime when you look into someone tells you something, your first response is negative. When a circumstance and situation comes, we always tend to be negative. There are always two options. Every moment existence provides you a circumstance, a situation. You are driving, somebody gives you a bad drive. You are going to check in at the airport, something happens. Every moment naturally negative tends to sink in. How to see positive in the negative is the second sutra of Atisha, very important sutra. One of the Naqshbandi Sufi, Shakuntala Devi, who happened to be my grandmother, always emphasized on be always happy. Whenever somebody will touch her feet or pay respect to her, she will not say God bless you. Many times people say naturally and unconsciously God bless you. It seems to me as if the person is the custodian of God. He can say anything on behalf of God. It is impossible to say anything on your own behalf and you are speaking on behalf of someone that you have never known as yet. So she used to say always be happy. When I was growing, I didn't understand the meaning. Then I have included in one of the 11 commandments. In Sufi terminology, it is known as Kalmat. Some of these were given by different masters, and this 12th Kalmat is introduced by Shakuntala Devi, and I had included in the Kalmats, the commandments of the Sufis. You can make this as a meditation. When a circumstance or situation comes, you have an option to accept it or not to accept it, to be happy or not to be happy. You practice it, you decide that every hour of the day when a circumstance and situation comes, consciously you will try to be happy. In the beginning you will miss many a times, but that is not a problem. If you miss it and then you remember that I missed, I decided that I have to be happy and I missed it, it is perfectly okay. You are aware of your awareness and you are aware in the moments when you are not aware. You have chosen to be happy, you missed it, but you are aware that you have missed it. Process is continuing. Then it will happen that slowly and slowly happiness or acceptance will become your climate. We say things, God willing, let thy will prevail, but these are all lip services. When things do not happen your way, there is always a complaint on your lips. When you look at the life of Sufis, there is never complaint on their life. In their talks, you will always find they say God will. Either the Sufi will begin with God willing, or in the middle, the sentence God willing will come, or he will end the sentence with God willing. Someone asked a Sufi, can I come to see you? Yes, you can come, God willing. Every moment, every talk is a reminder that nothing can happen without the will of the Divine. You have decided to go to see the Master. It is in your hand, you have decided. You get ready. Many things can happen. You set your alarm. The alarm may not ring at the right moment or you have set it wrong. You come out, you start your car, it is not starting. You took the other car of your wife, but the car that is parked in front and your wife's car is parked behind that. Your car is not starting. Many things like that can happen. You have reached the destination, but the master is not there. So one of these Sufi poets, that they are known as Qawwals, they sing the glories of the Lord and the Master in a poetic form, in a song. He says, I am going to meet the master, but I wish I can meet him. How can that be possible? You are going to meet him, and yet you are saying that I wish I could meet him. Yes, this is God's willingness. If God is willing, if the master is willing, first the call has to come from the master, then the way will be paved for you to reach there. If God does not call you, or the master or the sheikh does not call you, many obstructions will come on your way and you will not know. This is the essence of the second sutra of Atisha's mind training. Now the second sutra. Always rely on just a happy frame of mind. If you are unhappy, that simply means that you have learned the tricks of being unhappy. Everybody knows the trick how to be unhappy. And nothing else. Unhappiness depends on the frame of your mind. There are people who are unhappy in all kinds of situations. You make a nice dish. You ask your wife or your husband, how is it tasting? It's tasting all right, but if it was so, it would have been better. Always things like this. There are people who are unhappy in all kinds of situations. They have a certain quality in their mind which transforms everything into unhappiness. If you tell them about the beauty of the rose, they immediately say, and they start counting the thorns. You say to them, what a beautiful morning, what a sunny day, and they will look at you as if they are surprised by your statement. You talk about the beauty of the flower, they will talk about the thorns. They will say, so what? One day between two dark nights? It is only one day between two dark nights. So what is the big deal? Why are you looking so fascinated? The same thing can be seen from positive reference. Then suddenly each night is surrounded by 2 days. And then suddenly it is a miracle that the rose is possible, that such a delicate flower is possible among so many thorns. Everything is same. All depends on what kind of frame of mind you are carrying with you. Millions of people are carrying crosses on their shoulders, and naturally they are burdened. Their life is a drag. If you look at the person, if you talk to them, you will immediately realize that their energy is burdened. There is no lightness. The feet are too heavy. Their life is a drag. Their frame is such that it immediately becomes focused on everything that is negative. It magnifies the negative. Indeed, it is a morbid or pathological approach towards life. But they go on thinking, what can we do? The world is such. There is no way that I could change the world. No, the world is not such. The world is absolutely neutral. It has thorns, it has roses, it has nights and it has days. It has beauty, it has ugliness. The world is utterly neutral and balanced. It has all. It depends on you as to what you choose. If you have decided to choose only the wrong, you will live in a wrong kind of world, because you will live in your own self-choosing world. That is how people create hell and heaven on the earth. It looks very unbelievable that Buddha lived on the earth with the same kind of people, yet he lived in paradise. And you also live on the same earth with the same kind of people, and you live in hell. Now there are two possibilities. The political mind says, change the world. The religious mind says, change the frame of your mind. Religion and politics are diametrically opposite. There is a possibility that one day science and religion can meet and merge to create a new symphony. Sooner or later, science and religion are bound to meet and merge into one another. Maybe the direction is different. Science searches the outer and the religion the inner. But the search, the quality of the search remains the same. The spirit of search is the same, but there is no possibility that politics and religion can ever meet. Politics always thinks the world is wrong, therefore change the society, the economic structure, this and that. And everything will be okay once change the economic structure and things like these. The religion says The world has always been the same and will remain the same. You can change only one thing, the context of your mind, the space of your mind, then everything will be fine and good for you. Always rely on just a happy frame of mind. Let it become one of the fundamental rules of your life. Even if you come across a negative, find something positive in it. I remember my uncle, the Sufi master, Sufi Omkar Nath, sent me a couple. Shayad Khiza se ho koi nai surat bahar ki. Khiza means autumn. Khiza se ho koi nai surat bahar ki. Bahar means spring. Kuch maslihat isi mein hai mere parwardigar ki. What is the wish of my master in it, I know it not. Each time when autumn comes, all the leaves fall, the tree becomes bare, the spring is gone, all the beauty of the tree is gone. We cannot see beauty in autumn, but autumn has its own beauty. All around there is gold and the red leaves. The tree is without leaves and foliage. It has its beauty. It is the way the tree protects itself against the snow. And then when the spring comes, the spring brings a new portrait to the spring. Always remember, always see positive in negative. Even if you come across a negative, find something positive in it. You will always be able to find something, and the day you become skillful in finding the positive in the negative, you will dance with joy. Try it as the new vision of life. Think in terms of optimism. Do not be a pessimist. The pessimist creates a hell around him and lives in it. Certainly you live in the world you create. Remember, there is not only one world. Instead, there are as many worlds as there are minds on the earth. I live in my own world. You live in your own world. They are different and never overlap. They are utterly different. They exist on different planes. Atisha makes it a fundamental rule for his disciples to live in a happy frame of mind. Then you start turning each opportunity into a challenge for growth. For example, somebody insults you. Now it is so clear that you have been insulted. How can you practice the happy frame of mind now? Yes, it can be practiced. Insult a Buddha and you will know. You always have a choice to choose out of the two options available to you. It happened. Gautam Buddha once reached to a village where he was not supposed to go. Every morning he will get dressed, put on his cloak, pick up his begging bowl and go in any particular direction. As he reached to the village, people gathered, sermon began and people will gather. So it happened, he was passing through a village. The villagers were very much against him. It was impossible for them to comprehend what he was teaching. Compared to the Buddhas, the whole world is always very primitive, unsophisticated. The people gathered and insulted him very much. Buddha listened very silently and then said, "If you are finished, I can take leave of you, because I have to reach to the other village and they must be waiting for me. If you are not finished, then when I return tomorrow morning, you can come again and finish your job." One man from the crowd asked, "Have you not heard us? We have been insulting and abusing you. We have been using all kinds of dirty words, everything that we can find." Buddha laughed. He said, "You have come a little too late. You should have come 10 years ago. Then I was in the same frame of mind as you are now. Then I would have replied. I would have replied well. I would have killed you then. But now, this is simply an opportunity for me to be compassionate towards you and your ignorance and to be meditative. I am thankful to you that you have allowed this opportunity to see whether I respond or react. This is just a test of whether or not I have anything of the negative lurking anywhere in my unconscious mind. This is Buddha's mind. You are all sleeping Buddha. Awaken that Buddha that is asleep in you, your life. And I am happy to declare to you, friends, that not even a single shadow of negative has passed through my mind. I have remained utterly blissful. You have not been able to affect me in any way. And I am tremendously happy that you gave me such a great opportunity. Very few people are as kind as you are." This is how one should use every situation when they present themselves to you. This is how a seeker should use negative opportunities for inner growth, inner understanding, love, meditativeness and compassion. And once you have learned this frame of mind, or this positive vision of life, you will be surprised. It starts functioning in a totally different way. It starts mothering you. It starts helping you in every possible. It becomes a great friend. To know this, that existence mothers you, is to know God. There is no other God. Just this feeling, this tremendous feeling, this penetrating feeling that the existence loves you, protects you, helps you, and showers many blessings. Indeed, the existence is graceful towards you, that you are not a stranger, that this is your home. To feel that existence is my home is to know God. Feel that this existence is my home is to know God.